Hello and welcome. This is Sarah Dresser, clinical hypnotherapist. And today I'm going to talk about one of the reasons we get stuck when trying to make a positive change. So if you've decided to take on any form of therapy, whether self-directed or with a therapist, you are looking for positive results. The resolution of an issue, healing an old emotional wound, releasing an unhelpful habit. But just what are some of those reasons we get stuck? Where we find we just can't change, and why? So before I get into just exactly what are secondary gains, I want to touch on the other factors for you to make a positive change in therapy, particularly if working one-on-one in person. So there are a few issues even before we get to secondary gains as to why there may be a blockage to change. There may not be sufficient rapport between therapist and client, not enough trust for the client to relax in hypnosis in particular. The client has omitted vital information by design or by accident, or the therapist is not skilled enough in that issue, or has not personalized the session well enough to use the right imagery, the right techniques, the right language, and so on to resonate with the client. So the summary of all of that is to say, success is teamwork. It is not solely in the client's hands, nor the hands of the therapist. But let's assume everything is in place and nothing else is missing. Great rapport, all the information present and correct as far as they both know, and well-designed sessions. Here is where secondary gains may come into play. So in therapy, what are we doing? We are resolving issues, but what we are going through is a change. The ending of an issue means the beginning of something else, and all change is an unknown. As we change and release an issue, we need to consider, what do I gain and what do I lose? Now, this may be a challenge for some of you to accept. How can I lose? If I stop emotional eating, I might lose some weight, but that's great, that's positive. If I get over my agoraphobia, I can go out and see my friends again. I only gain. But let's look at the other side. So on the topic of overeating, I had one client who, deeper into her session, said that when she had previously lost weight, she got a lot of comments at work. These comments were probably well intended, but she found it so insulting that people would emphasize just how much weight she had lost. She felt insulted for her past self. Reading between the lines, it seemed that she took the messaging that it was perhaps even shameful that she should have been that big previously. And also the attention made her very uncomfortable. So she put on the weight again, almost to defy the shaming that she had interpreted. She hadn't let go of identifying with that self that carried the extra weight. On further questioning, when I went back in time with her in session, she also mentioned that she had always been slim through her adult life, but after some years she felt unhappy with her husband and started to drift apart. So she started to eat so he would not want to be intimate with her. She essentially ate to create a shield of protection around her. They eventually divorced, but now, as well as the shame and attention that she felt from colleagues, she also felt she needed that layer of protection. Now single again, she did not want attention from other men. So this alone is an example of a secondary gain. A benefit that we derive at some conscious or subconscious level from the issue that we have. I'd go even deeper than that and say that secondary gains are actually just part of our identity. Let's look at another example. So a second potential client came to my attention when their mother approached me. Her daughter had a few issues, including OCD and agoraphobia. When the mother approached me, she mentioned how much her daughter was fighting the OCD. the urge to continually wash her hands, and how she was doing her best to build up the courage to go outside. It really sounded like they both wanted to overcome the issue. But just as the conversation was ending, the mother mentioned that the daughter had said that if she resolved her agoraphobia, she would have to get a job, and she wasn't sure if she wanted that. So in this example, I don't doubt that they both wanted the daughter to overcome her issues. In the case where someone comes on behalf of someone else, I would never take on a client unless they wanted to come to me. And with regards to the agoraphobic daughter, her secondary gain was the benefit of dependence. Leaving home for the first time is a little daunting for all of us, even if we're absolutely ready to head out the door. So these are just two examples of secondary gains. Now I do want to emphasize that secondary gains should not be considered an unwillingness to change, or that any client is just proving to themselves that they can't change. But when anyone uses language like, "I will need a miracle," or that they doubt so much that I can make a difference, what I hear instead is that they may have lived with the issue for so long that it is hard to imagine a change. And perhaps there is a deep-seated secondary gain. A secondary gain can be a direct benefit, as I've illustrated. But this is not to say it is calculated. Secondary gains often lie below our conscious awareness. And however much information a client gives to me, it is quite surprising what can come up in hypnosis itself. Secondary gains can be a benefit, but I prefer the interpretation that our issue is a tight-knit part of our identity. So, as a hypnotherapist, I have always found that following up hypnotherapy after the release of an issue, with coaching support to help the client understand their identity free of those issues, is an ideal approach. Once the issue is gone, the client needs assistance in understanding who they are now. So what can we get from today's video? First of all, if you are still experiencing issues, it does not mean that you have a secondary gain. You may not have found the right session with the right technique, or there may be more than one issue interlinked. This is why I do several sessions on the same topic. Second of all healing is teamwork. It is not all in your therapist's hands, and it is not all in your hands. So if you are thinking about one-on-one sessions, find a therapist who is not only skilled and experienced, but someone you feel that you can trust. I'll put a link to my article on how to help you find the right therapist in the video description. So much depends not only on the skill and expertise of your therapist, but also trust and rapport. Thirdly, and most importantly, I hope you realize it does not matter how long you have had the issue. There is always a potential for positive change. And even if you have tried different modalities, different therapy types in the past, and they have failed, it doesn't mean there isn't a solution. There are always options. Fourthly, you don't need to believe that you can change. You don't even need to be 100% in favor of the change. If you have some reluctance to change, especially for those pleasurable habits like junk food eating or drinking, just go in with an open mind and commit. Fifthly and lastly, if a secondary gain comes up, it is okay. While some would say a secondary gain is a benefit and a sign that you don't want to change, I would actually say that you need extra support to understand who you are, what is your identity without this issue anymore. And as oftentimes secondary gains lie below conscious awareness, this is why I feel hypnotherapy is so beneficial, because the mind will always show what is at the root cause of an issue, so long as the client permits this reveal. So I hope this video has been helpful. Feel free to put any questions or comments below. My name is Sarah Dresser, clinical hypnotherapist, and as always, I'm here to support you to unlock your life.